Hi, everybody. It's so nice to be here to talk about monitoring amphibian diversity in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park with environmental DNA. And I'll be co-presenting today with Erin Canter. And I'm starting acknowledging my co-authors, Will Kuhn, Leonardo Maciel, Rob DeSalle, and Erin Aunins. And as well as to acknowledge some of the funding sources. And I really want to give a big thank you to Paul Super, who was really amazing in welcoming us to the park and setting the whole project up and introducing me to Erin and Paul and Erin and sorry, Will. So thank you so much. Thanks for the Friends of the Smokies, the Institute for Comparative Genomics at the Natural History Museum here in New York, where the lab work was done, as well as some funding sources and all of the students and volunteers, and most of all to the Great Smoky National Park, Mountains National Park. So to give an overview, pretty soon I'll be handing this over to Erin with her amazing expertise on amphibians. And most of the talk will be alternating between the two of us while Erin talks about the traditional surveys and I discuss the environmental DNA surveys. And we'll follow the pretty standard format that we're all familiar with, going from introduction through methods, results, discussion. To start with the bad news, unfortunately, amphibians, as you probably know, are suffering alarming declines around the world due to disease habitat loss, climate change, and other factors. And they are indeed the most threatened vertebrate class, with almost 41% of them being globally threatened. And we can see in this map their distribution and the importance of the Smoky Mountains. And now I'll pass it over to Erin.
Great. So Jenny had just mentioned, and y'all probably know, that we're in the salamander capital of the world. There is just a massive amount of amphibian diversity here in the Smokies. It's providing refuge for over 45 species of amphibians, so frogs and salamanders more specifically. But understanding some of the more cryptic taxa is pretty insufficient. So below you'll have a couple salamanders in the genus Desmognathus. And you can see even among species, they're very similar, sometimes hard to tell apart in the field. And then you have a seal salamander on the left and then our turkey black belly on the right, which we of course recently realized through genetic testing that they're actually quite distinct species. And so sometimes just understanding who is out there and where they are is a little bit tricky. And so one way that we want to combat that or try to advance the knowledge of where these species are and how they're distributed throughout the park is combining environmental DNA as well as traditional visual surveys. And so Jenny will talk more about the environmental DNA in a minute, but essentially just like humans, any species, if we are entering into, for example, this vernal pond that's in Cades Cove, we're shedding tiny little bits of ourselves in DNA. And so what we're doing with traditional surveys is going out and visually seeing either the species themselves or evidence of them, like maybe their egg masses and things like that. With eDNA, we can go out and survey that water. And even if we didn't see those species, we can get a better picture of who is using these systems. So to give a little bit of context for what I mean by those traditional surveys, we have over three decades of visual survey data specifically for the egg masses of both spotted salamanders and wood frogs. So in this photo, we have two star volunteers, Mark Weingartz and Laura Dixon, who are out counting wood frog egg masses. And we're using the same protocols that were used in the early 90s that were developed by Dr. Jim Petrenka and Dr. Charles Smith. And then eventually this project was given over to the Great Smoky Mountains Institute at Tremont, which is an environmental learning center here in Tennessee. And Amy already talked a little bit about the value of citizen science, but it is not only to engage members of the public in the scientific process, but also to collect way more data than a single researcher or a single lab could collect. And so if you're not familiar already with these target species that we're talking about when we're looking at wood frogs, we have a little mating pair here on the left, and then you have some egg masses there on the right. And so you can see these are like early stage, each little clump represents one successfully breeding female wood frog. And so in that way, we can count these egg masses to determine how many wood frogs are using this space successfully. And then our other target species is one of the ambystoma species of salamanders, our spotted salamander, and they have visually distinct egg masses, even though they co-occur at the same temporal time. So they're both like in winter areas, these vernal ponds that are filling in late winter, early spring. And so we're going out, and again, each mass of egg, so collection or conglomerate of eggs, represents one successful breeding female. And so over time, when we're collecting these egg mass counts, so we're recording just how many they are, as well as what stage of embryonic development they are in. And in that way, over a period, a season of the vernal pond from mid-January to about now in mid-March, it's like the breeding season, from wood frogs mating and laying eggs to them emerging as tadpoles, we can sort of tell how many of these egg masses were newly laid, and therefore how many successful breeding pairs may we have had for each year. And then we're also recording information about the environment, so specifically trying to think about how those might impact the species. So what is the depth year after year in specific locations, as well as temperature and pH? And like I said, this data goes back 30 years now.
So now I'll come back and talk about expanding the objective a little bit further in terms of the eDNA study in particular. So we want to ask questions such as, is there any variation in amphibian biodiversity across temporal periods, study sites, substrates, such as water or sediment, genetic loci, pH or temperature? And we're very interested to know whether species that are common, which we would expect to find, are detected, but also whether some of the rare, cryptic, or organisms of management concern can be found, and is there anything entirely unexpected that we're finding? And very importantly, how do the environmental DNA results compare to those of traditional surveys? Because they can be quite different, like your Venn diagram might not overlap as much as one might think it would, just because they are just different methods. So it's always good to ground truth them. And then most importantly, what are the management and conservation implications? We want to do research that's useful for the park. So here you can see there's Will collecting samples with Laura Dixon and equipment that was loaned by Erin Aunins of the U.S. Geological Survey, who helped us really set up the project. And you can see we're using gloves. Everything is kind of sterile, so there's no contamination. And what they did is they dipped the tube into this the pond water to get surface samples and pumped it into a Sterivex filter that collected the DNA. And they also collected sediment samples, so surface sediment, using sterile scoops. And they did this at about 5 different sites in the park, and each site had 1 to 3 ponds. Sometimes the water had evaporated or just wasn't there. And so we have more sediment samples than we have water samples. And we also measured pH and environment. There were 4 sampling events over the course of 2022 to 2023. These are some of the sample sites. They were chosen to match amphibian breeding sites. And the reason we focused on amphibians is because that is what the park told us they were most interested in. And you can see the diversity of sites, Methodist Pond, all the way through to Tremont Lagoons and Gum Swamp, Finley Cane. Then the samples were frozen and brought back up to New York City at the Natural History Museum, where in the Institute for Comparative Genomics, they were extracted using standard kits for this purpose and quantified using a qubit to know how much DNA was in there. And then we sent a subsample out to a professional company to give us an initial idea of what we were getting. And so that's what we're presenting here. So these are just preliminary results. And to just briefly explain what we're doing, Erin's already talked about the traditional surveys, which is how organisms are usually identified until there was this, you know, genetics kind of revolution and the idea of using DNA barcoding, which is sort of like going to a supermarket and you have that unique a barcode that you can figure out what you're, they can figure out the price of what you're buying. And so organisms vary in their DNA. And what was done, you know, in the 2000s or so was individual samples were collected. And at the time, this was a big revolution. Individual samples were collected and sequenced. And there was a wide standardization effort so that people were sequencing the same thing so that they could deposit on a genetic reference base. And then anyone in the world could consult and see if what they found, so for example, in their, you know, illegal wildlife trade interception, if they could identify, you know, what that organism was. And so this was, for example, used in a caviar to determine whether what was advertised in the can was actually what people were paying money to eat. And it wasn't always exactly correct. And now there's been another huge revolution, and this is a relatively new field, although it's really gained a lot of traction. So I remember starting this in about 2014, and this is just multiplying DNA barcoding by a lot, by millions. And so instead of sampling individuals, which can cause them some stress or mortality and a lot of effort in the field, you can just get a water sample, a soil sample. Yesterday, I was talking to someone who was doing the aerome. So an air sample, a subway platform sample, and sequence that. And so when we amplify target parts, is the DNA is so enormous that we couldn't look at all of it. So we look at the useful parts for our questions, and to enable reading those, we have to amplify them, which is sort of like making a Xerox copy of all of these samples. So it'd be like taking a page in a book from an encyclopedia and then trying to make Xerox copies of that to figure out, better learn what was on that page. And the importance of the reference database is essential, because if one has something that is not on the reference database, one is not then able to identify it. So what we found so far is that the universal primer used for DNA barcoding, cytochrome oxidase 1, this is used in animals, metazoans, is working pretty nicely, as well as the 16S, which is also a promising primer, part of the genome. You can see here the mitochondrial genome of this frog. We're only looking at a few parts of it, and we're not looking at the nuclear genome, because these are the parts that are informative and are on the reference database. And so what did we find so far? We found it was really easy to identify wood frogs. So these Lithobeta sylvaticus that Erin is also monitoring were found in our positive control, where we just submitted a control to what we expect to check that those species are in fact there. We also have negative controls to ensure there's no contamination. And so Lithobeta sylvaticus was the best one, amplified in the controls, amplified in the field for both of the genetic loci. But other species also worked out well, especially the genera, as was mentioned in the previous presentation. Sometimes we have to go up a level on lose some resolution in eDNA, which is a limitation of it. But we did find most of the ambystoma species, ambystoma, but we noticed that there are some that we would not be able to find anyway, because they're not in the on GenBank, which is the genetic depository. So now our project is taking on a new direction of trying to populate the genetic depository with whole mitochondrial genomes of the species that are missing. And that will enable us to better identify what we found with eDNA, but it's also a pretty significant contribution to the park in order characterizing those genomes, and also just to research in general, to have those on the reference database. And the same for Desmognathus and Plethodon, but they were less commonly detected than Ambystoma. So now I'll pass it back over to Erin.
So Jenia mentioned earlier just how threatened globally amphibian species are. And we know a lot of that is for agricultural and land use change. Within the park, we're not having those issues currently. Of course, there has been a lot of land use change over time, but there are still, you can see variations in the success rate of breeding populations over the years. So this is all of our study sites from that 30-year traditional survey data. Going back 30 years, I do want to draw your attention to the fact that we always have significantly more wood frog eggs than we do spotted salamanders. And so the scales are different. So we have up to 11,000 for wood frogs, only up to under 2,000 for the spotted salamanders. But regardless, you can see that over time, there are great fluctuations within the populations. Like in 2007, there's hardly any. And so we have to look back at environmental data and say, like, what are the things that are causing this? It's no longer agriculture. So like, what are the impacts, the environmental impacts that could be having such a great impact on the species themselves. And one of the possibilities is just thinking through the hydro period. So this is in one particular vernal pond in Cades Cove. We're looking at depth, the water depth within each year, as well as how many spotted salamander egg masses were counted. Again, that being a proxy for successful breeding populations in the area. And you can see that when depth goes in 2007, there was a complete drought and the pond never filled with water. And you can see there's a lag time for how that could impact the species. So spotted salamanders' natural history has an impact on this. They take 3 to 4 years once they emerge from the pond to go back to that same area to breed. And so you might have a longer hydro period. So for example, in 2011, even 2013, really long hydro period, meaning that pond was filled with water for much longer. It could have allowed every single egg to potentially successfully become a salamander to emerge and return a few years later and have that spike, for example, in 2015. And so one of the really cool things about doing both of these in conjunction with each other is how complementary they are. So, you know, we mentioned that through traditional surveys, we can see like this in situ actual quantification of egg masses and how many of these individual wood frogs and spotted salamanders are breeding. And we might also sort of tangentially notice marbled salamander larvae at the same time. But we actually can't tell like who specifically is there without looking for them. And even if we are looking for them, like we mentioned with some of the Desmognathus salamanders, they're so phenotypically similar, it's very hard to tell them apart. And so this is a photo by Todd Pearson of a mole salamander, so another Imbistema species, that was actually detected using eDNA in some of our survey sites that we have never actually visually seen within these pools. And so they have, of course, been seen in the national park, but the breeding area that they were more commonly seen in is now no longer filling with water most years. And so it's really cool for us to know, okay, one, who is there? And then also, could we, with our traditional data, go back and we have relative abundance of sequences we find. Can we use the traditional data to determine, okay, like maybe we can go back and try to find an equation that could quantify using the eDNA how many of these species or even relative abundance of species that we might find in these areas?
Wonderful. So our next steps, we still do have some lab work to finish. We're excited about adding these whole mitochondrial genomes or the missing taxa to the reference library. And we're very, very interested in combining the amphibian genetic data with the ongoing traditional surveys. And Erin has really interesting management applications to discuss.
Yes. And I know the Park Service is stretched thin in terms of how they're allocating resources, but they can see in this photo, this is an image from the Tremont Lagoons. So this is a vernal pond right outside the Tremont Institute in Tennessee. And you can see that when an area that was normally completely filled with water now has some woody encroachment. We know this area is used by wood frogs, as many other salamanders and reptiles and other species. And so we can help to justify the prioritization and allocation of resources to managing these vernal ponds that we know are so important for the natural history of amphibians.
So to conclude, and we're just about out of time, once complete, this work combining amphibian genetic data with ongoing traditional surveys will provide complementary information important for managing vulnerable amphibians in the Great Smoky Mountains with applications for other taxa and sites. And with that, I'll say thank you so much. Sorry there wasn't time for questions. And here's our contact information.